First, you need to know Hand of God is a wild, weird, wonderful ride. So just get ready. And it basically stars Ron Perlman as a judge who believes that he's hearing the voice of God through his comatose son, that he should avenge his suicide. So it's dark and it's kind of twisted. I was excited about being on Amazon. I feel like Amazon is the future. That's what it is, streaming, you know, that's how we're all seeing things now. That's how we're seeing this, I believe. And so that's where it's at. So I wanted to see what that world was like. Plus, it's directed and produced by Mark Forster, who has never done television before. He's only done movies, so that was of interest to me. I play Crystal Harris, the wife of Ron Perlman, and I'm seemingly the woman behind the man, but I have my own agenda, and I have my own plan, and not as all is not as it seems.
I play Jocelyn Harris, the daughter-in-law to Judge Purnell and Crystal Harris. I am the wife of the comatose son, and I think, needless to say, we all fit in with the aftermath of the mental breakdown that Ron Perlman's character goes through and how it affects everybody, especially having my husband be in a hospital bed, brain dead. It's actually quite simple. She's having to deal with just having seen her husband or found her husband after his attempted suicide and unsuccessful suicide. Traumatic, raw, not really understanding what's happening. On top of everything, she has to deal with Ron Perlman's character, Purnell Harris, who is seemingly losing his mind and driving everybody around him nuts. And what you really, really see her try to pull things back together, try to gain her strength and try to decide what it is that she's about to do next. How does she survive the very next moment? And she decides to fight. And that's, going to be an interesting ride. None of us are really one thing or another. That's really the focus. Ben, actually, our creator, showrunner, mentions this quite often, that it's, he doesn't want anybody to be one thing or another. It's really left to the viewers to decide. It's not whether people are good or bad. It's that people are good and bad. And I really like it when he says that, because it resonated so much with me. It made a lot of sense, and you'll see that as a viewer.
Well, you know, the bigger, I think, theme in Hand of God, especially being the title Hand of God, is how people use religion and what is real and what isn't, what is faith. You know, when we look at the world today, religion is used a lot for power to get what people want, you know, to their own ends. Or maybe there is true faith. Who knows? And maybe Purnell really is hearing from God. And wouldn't that be wonderful in many ways if he was? And it's kind of like the hand of God. It's interesting. Some people think of the hand of God as something oppressive, you know, that's condemning and sees you and holds you down. Or you could look at the hand of God as something uplifting that is there for you and lifts you up. So it's all about interpretation. And I think that's what the whole show is, too, is how do you interpret that? How does Crystal interpret these visions? As far as I'm concerned, she thinks they're bull. You know, she thinks this is nonsense. Move on with your life. However, by the end of the 10 episodes, when you have to watch and stay with it, she might feel differently. Ron Perlman, as we know, is a force of nature. And I've known him for a long time, but I've never gotten to work with him before. So that's been really great. He's just an actor. You know, he's an actor's actor. He loves to act. And he's kind of a pussycat, which is the big secret about Ron Perlman. He's quite a softy underneath it all. But there's not a lot of actors that could bring that larger than life command that he has, and you go for the ride because you just want to see what is this guy going to do and how's he going to handle it. And I like an actor that scares you a little bit. You don't quite know what he's going to do next, and I just think there should always be an amount of danger in people's acting, and Ron's definitely got that. I think it's just Ron's face is scary. I mean, right from the start, you see him in this fountain naked. What could be scarier than that? really, you have to watch it. That's all I'm going to say.
Ron is a let's put it this way. If you've ever seen Ron, you won't forget Ron, right? If in anything. And he just brings, other than, like Dana said, he's a pussycat. He's loving and lovely and hugs people and is charming and funny more than anything, I think. He's a giving, supporting, wonderful actor to work opposite. And it's nice, like Dana said, to just never know what he's going to do next because it's exciting. It keeps things fresh. And I don't think I could ask for anything more than that. And I got that in a few of our cast members. And I have to say, Andre Arroyo is a revelation in his role. You would not expect Mayor Bobo to be that. And I believe from the stories that I've heard from Ben and Mark, he walked in and just, it was undeniable. And it was the same for a few of the other characters. Garrett Dillahunt is one of my favorite people on the planet. He plays this scary psycho. And Garrett is, we're all pretty much the farthest thing from our characters, it seems like, right? Funny, loving human being, and watching him transform into this character is quite incredible. Julian Morris, who is quite possibly the most charming human being on the planet, you know, and plays this devious, agenda-filled character, and Elizabeth McLaughlin, who plays Alicia, his right-hand, devoted companion, and she's just a 21-year-old, 70-year-old soul, it seems like. She's just the most, well, not 70, because, right, she's very, she seems older than she is, but she's, because she's so mature and so brings so much to this character that wasn't supposed to, you would think, be this interesting character, turns out to be so interesting, so heartfelt. Emma Yahtzee, who plays Tessie, I believe steals.
Can you pronounce her last name?
I can't.
Me neither.
That's Mayatsi. It took everybody, and she doesn't. She's not gonna be mad. She knows. She doesn't eat. She can be like Madonna.
Right.
How about
right,
that? Emma Yahtzee. Just Emma Yahtzee. And when you see her, you'll know. Who am I forgetting? You, me. That's it.
Yeah, I think that's it.
At first, I was intimidated because you think Mark Forster, you think, you know, Monsters Ball, Finding Neverland, World War Z, Quantum of Solace, and you just go, and then you come in and he's this smiling, supporting, trustworthy man, and you just, you fly. That's what it felt like. It felt like you could do anything, and you knew that he was there watching and he had your back. It's hard to explain the sense of leadership that he brought, right? He's an artist. And he doesn't impose his presence. It's, I'm trying to find the exact word. It's hard to explain, but it was collaborative. It was fearless. I think I've done the best work I've ever done in my entire life, knowing that he was there. And it just set the bar very, very, very high.
Mark Forster was never done television before. He is my favorite type of director, and I wish all directors were like this, especially on TV, because he leaves you alone. He just casts it. He knows who he wants, and he just trusts that you know how to do your job. And he's the kind of director that just keeps saying less, less, strip it away, so that you just get to the essence, and it's just pure, as opposed to a lot of directors on TV. They do this kind of, more energy, give me something more, 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 and it just keeps ruining it. So I was just so relieved, you know, to have a director like this. And I think he brings an elegance to the piece. He and Ben Watkins, who created it, are a good team, because Ben has this wild imagination that is full of ideas, and then Mark brings this kind of cool visual sense to it that somehow counterbalances the imaginative, and I think it's a really winning combination. What most actors could tell you is if you're doing a dark drama, you have more fun on set. And if you're doing a comedy, it's very serious on set. So that's true. I mean, comedy is hard. Like they say, it's hard. Right. People take those laughs very seriously. But no, we have a great time. We're a close group. On this tour that we've been doing through Europe, we're out every night drinking, eating, with Ron leading the charge. So we're a family.
because we've done this, we know that the darker the material, the funnier it is on set. And I think it's true for life as well. The darker the situation, you'll find humor in it because it's just normal. Otherwise, it's just, you can't deal with it. Who can deal with that? And the show is not even that dark, I find. There's a lot of humor in our show. Yeah. A lot of humor. And surprisingly so. And remember when we saw it in a couple of screenings, I was taken aback and actually quite pleased with the amount of laughs that we got. I don't want people to think it's that dark. There are lighter moments and moments that just, they need to be there, and they are there. And we did the same thing on set, and it just lent to a really fun environment that we all really want to come back to. There's a scene where my comatose husband, we had to film him getting a boner or an erection. And not that alone is entertaining because it was a whole discussion on how to do it. That looks too pointy. That's too round, or that's too big, or that's too small. Meanwhile, there's a grip underneath Johnny, who plays my husband, under his leg, doing the move, and then her character walks in, and she's drunk as hell, just drunk. And I leave the room, and I'm looking at the monitor, and Dana just does this thing where she's so drunk, and she plops down on the bed, but right where the erection is.
And I put my head in it.
and it's so wrong. It's so funny. And I don't know if it's going to make it in. I really, really hope it does. It was so funny. And on the same day, I also introduced Dana to turtles having sex sounds on YouTube, because that's what you do naturally when you're shooting that. And I think that's when we fell in love, if I do say so myself. That's good.
If you can, go on YouTube and look up turtles having sex, which Alona shared with me, and they do the sound of right, as opposed to dolphins, which is this is what we do on set.
Coming up on season 2 of Hand of God.
I think everybody was a little different. I don't like to know. I told Ben I don't want to know what's going to happen because, you know, there's so few surprises in life. I want some to last. So I didn't know where my character was going until the 10th episode. And I don't even know, honestly, that Ben knew. I think that he claims to have a 5-year plan. He knows where the story is going. But the great thing about TV is you have to be open to things happening, you know, happenstance, just that make you think, oh, well, maybe we should go in that direction. So I think he changed his mind maybe towards episode 7 about where the show a little bit changed, veered off a little bit, and I think people are going to be happy.
And there's pluses and minuses to both, because you get to really, really plant things knowing the entire arc as you would in a movie. However, Ben let me know in advance that was not going to happen. I don't know if it's because he, like Dana said, that he didn't even know, because once you get your actors and once you get your writers and you discover new things, and all of a sudden new ideas come and creativity, inspiration comes, and maybe he changed his mind. I enjoyed it this time around. I enjoyed this process. It allowed me to be very much in the moment and enjoy what we were doing right now, and then be surprised and excited about the next episode. So there's really beautiful things about the two ways of working on a show.
Where we left off with episode 10, yeah, is I don't want to give anything away, but it kind of turns everything upside down. So I am excited. I hope we come back, because it's certainly, I can't give away too much, but it certainly changes the whole landscape. So for me, it would be really interesting, because Crystal will be another person, not literally, but she has to go through a whole different journey now.
And that's why we can't explain what we want.
Yeah, no, we can't really. And your character doesn't know yet, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Because Alona knows what she's talking about. You don't know what she's talking about. You guys don't know what she's talking about yet. Maybe so. I would like for her to somehow be a little bit more privy to the main, to know more about what's going on with Purnell. Because she's a little separate. She's a little in her own tragedy, kind of. The main character in her own world, and I would like for her to start meeting and getting weaved into this world that Ben has created with the rest of the characters and how they're all kind of connected. Even though she's very connected, she's still very, very separate, and I would like to see her get more invested in that. At the risk of sounding cliche, it's everything. You know, you're out there as an actor, as a viewer, as well as an actor, watching these amazing shows being made. And I know I was just praying and hoping that I would get the chance to be a part of something like that. And the probability of that is slim because there's a million of me. Do you know what I mean? Of girls who...
There's now a million shows, too.
Exactly. Not a million shows, but a million actors and actresses, especially, you know, in Los Angeles that are up for it and coming, fighting, and clawing their way into it. When you read a script like that, when you know where it's at, and when you know that Amazon is behind it, and it's this fearless, like a child that has no fear and has no boundaries, and they're just going headfirst into the deep water in the pool, you know, of this world, you want to be a part of it. You want to be with them. And so it means to me really fulfilling another level of my dream, which could very easily not have happened. And I'm aware of it. So I'm very, very grateful.
One of the main things I love about TV is just that thing that you can evolve. The show evolves, you evolve. You have a family around you, you know, the whole crew is part of the family. And then you also start to collaborate because the writer starts to see you, and you are the character at that point, and what you bring to the character. And like Julian Morris, who's in the show, he said evidently that Ben asked him, you know, what are you scared of? And then by episode 5, they had put that in the script. So I'm nervous that Ben's going to ask me what I'm afraid of, because it will end up in there. You know, they start using your life. And that's happened a lot to me on shows. And you just hope that you build a world that the world wants to watch, so they become part of your world too, so it becomes this meta thing, you know, where the audience starts participating also. Because if you're a smart showrunner, you listen to the audience, especially on Amazon, because they can write in, you know, and leave comments. So that's a whole nother thing. So I'll be curious what happens with Amazon, whether the audience, the customers, which is what Amazon calls them, actually have input into the show, which to me somewhat be part of the future. Oh, you know, it's so hard because the first show I ever did is probably my first love, you know, which was China Beach, and that was 25 years ago, you know? And I was really spoiled because it was such a great experience. I just thought everything was going to be like that, and I had no idea. But what I'm most proud of is the fact that I've gotten to do such varied things, you know, that I've been able to do comedy and drama, that I've been able to keep working, that I've been able to play strong women. And even on this show, on Hand of God, people at first were like, you're playing a wife? You don't play a wife. And then I explained, no, she's not just the wife. You know, when you think about it in real life, nobody is just the wife. It's more how people portray the wife in Hollywood. Wives are quite interesting people.
I've done a couple of independent films that I hope will get distribution, you know, fingers crossed. One is a romantic, not romantic, musical comedy, sorry. Well, a little romantic in there. Very, very different than Hand of God, obviously. And it's with Topher Grace and Taye Diggs and Anne Heche and J.C. Chazet and a bunch of other...
Are you singing it?
I do. Hey. I do. It's fun. And it's funny. And it was like a lot of laughs, which was very different coming off of Hand of God to doing that. And then I think they're calling... They changed the name recently, so it's hard. It was One Shot, and I think now it's Opening Night. That's what it's called. So hopefully, and it's very, very good. It's very, very good. And another movie called A Modern Love about same-sex marriage. And it's very relevant and very sweet and simple, and I really, really hope that people will get a chance to see that.
What do I have coming out? I did a French miniseries that starts in France this month on TF1. called Une Chance de Trop, or No Second Chance. So I'm in that, and I'm hoping to work more in Europe, actually. I feel like that would be a nice further step in my life to live here. So I'm working on my French. I already speak English, if anybody wants me here. And we'll see. I don't know. I just feel like it would be nice to have a little change of pace. I think that everyone should watch Hand of God because it's a wild ride. It's starring Ron Perlman, a lot of hot guys and hot girls. No, I'm joking now. No, it's a wonderfully written show, and it'll take you some places that will surprise you. Check it out.
Get on Amazon. Watch Hand of God because it's wonderful television making. And if you like to be challenged, if you like to have thought-provoking, emotion-evoking material at the leisure of your own home, please watch us. We'll be more than happy we made it for you, and we'll be more than happy if you watched it.